video game development can be a very, very strange and fickle thing. We've really seen every side of the spectrum throughout the years. Games with a short development cycle that were good, games with a long development cycle that sucked, but there's one aspect we have not discussed yet on the channel, and that's what we're going to do today. What's up, guys? Jimmy or Chaos, welcome to Chaos Top 10s, and today we are going to be counting down the top 10 games with rushed or short development cycles that actually suffered because of it, and the games ended up sucking. For this list, we're going to be looking at games that were given incredibly short development times, and they ended up being terrible. Before we get into it, we are running a $200 Amazon gift card giveaway the entire month. All you have to do to enter is like this video, be subscribed, turn on your notifications, and leave a comment why you want to win it with your Twitter handle attached. I will announce the winner at the end of the month on Twitter. Take advantage of the giveaway. Make sure you're subscribed with notifications on so you never miss an upload. Click the little bell, check the box, and you will receive a notification on mobile or on desktop whenever a new video goes live. And now, let's go over some games that got made really quickly, and they were really, really bad. Kicking off our list at number 10 today, we're going to start off with Mortal Kombat Mythology Sub-Zero. And it was pretty bad. It was released in October of 97 for the PS1 and later ported to the N64 and is actually a prequel to the first Mortal Kombat game where you play as the famous Sub-Zero, who is tasked by Quan Chi to hunt down an amulet. The game was developed in approximately 14 months and it definitely showed through with the final product as the game is, I mean, the only word I can think of is lame. It's incredibly basic and unoriginal, almost like they took existing games and just slapped the Mortal Kombat character models on top of them. The game was so hated that the planned MK Mythology series was actually canceled. Perhaps MK should just stick to fighting games and not try to go down this route anymore. Okay, I'm going to have some fans of this game, but I need you to hear me out on it, okay? At number 9, we have Battlefield 4. While development of Battlefield 4 wasn't too rushed, orders from EA to speed it up without warning is what could have doomed this FPS at launch. Things were coming along alright after DICE Studios until EA decided they wanted to beat Activision to the punch as the next Call of Duty game was set to launch before them. EA ordered DICE to speed up the development of Battlefield 4 so they could be one of the first one on the shelves. First to the shelves is a good thing usually, and the result was a catastrophe that went down in gaming history as one of the worst launches ever, as BF4 was virtually unplayable for weeks. EA and DICE were forced to apologize and rush to patch up their mess, and eventually they succeeded, and BF4 is now one of the best in the series. But it would have been much smarter if they had simply waited to release it and put it on the shelves right for the first time instead of having to beat their competitor to the punch. At number 8, we have Ju-on: The Grudge. This haunted house simulator for the Nintendo Wii was released in 2009 to critical panning for countless reasons. You played in first person as you used the Wii remote as your flashlight as you ventured through this house, and the Grudge Girl, everybody remembers the Grudge Girl, chases you around. Developed in 6 to 8 months, the game, obviously it's going to be horrible. It had horrible controls, it had bad graphics, which the developers should have seen coming when they started making it for the Wii, and it was incredibly short, and there was nothing scary about this haunted house simulator at all. Don't waste your money on this game, and better yet, don't waste your time if you've never played this game, because I promise you are guaranteed to be disappointed. Oh my gosh, this is just sad for me to even talk about now. At number 7, Halo: The Master Chief Collection, which started originally as just Halo 2 Remake, soon grew into this massive project spanning 4 games and over 10 years of awesomeness. But the key phrase there is started originally as just a Halo 2 Remake. 343 Industries started work on this now infamously broken game as just a remake of the classic Halo sequel in honor of its 10th anniversary. But Microsoft ordered that the rest of the Halo series be ported and included in the pack as well as a way to get Halo onto the Xbox One. We don't know exactly the order that it was given to include the rest of the games, but it definitely wasn't enough time, as Halo the Master Chief Collection was launched in late 2014 to pissed off gamers who found that the collection was completely and utterly broken. Achievements didn't work, the campaigns were buggy, and multiplayer, well, you didn't get to play multiplayer. We'll just leave it at that. It took months of patches before the game finally started running the way it was intended, but even then, it struggled with long matchmaking, wait times, and the lack of expected features from a Halo game. Sure, It has been fixed since then, and the Master Chief Collection is now one of the best purchases you can make for your money, but it took forever, and that's not fair to people that put up their hard-earned money. They want a completed product at launch. This next gem at number 6, this beauty was created in 9 months. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 5. One of the most famous and popular sports series of all time is the Tony Hawk series, specifically the Pro Skater games. The first four of these are legendary, all of which have critically acclaimed and being some of the best reviewed and best-selling sports games ever. So, you would think 5 would go right along suit, right? Activision wanted to bring the series back into the spotlight after a long hiatus, and Tony Hawk himself announced that Pro Skater 5 was in development in November of 2014. After approximately 9 months of development, there was the game. It was released that quick. The graphics were ugly, the game wasn't fun, and it was borderline unplayable because of the countless bugs present in the game. Activision even had to issue a patch to Pro Skater 5 that was even bigger than the game itself. And even it did not fix all the problems. It's a shame, too, because it's pretty unlikely we will ever get another Tony Hawk game after this. At number 5, Doctor Who? What? No, Doctor Who Return to Earth. How many of you out there are Doctor Who fans? And if you are, I want to encourage you not to play this game because it will probably make you hate the series. Released in 2010 for the Wii, Doctor Who Return to Earth was developed in approximately 7 months, likely to capitalize on the popularity of the show at the time, as it was just coming back. The game had terrible graphics, bad controls, and it was just a terrible game in general. Strangely enough, Nintendo and BBC were supposedly really excited about the game, saying they were happy to bring the Doctor Who fan base to Nintendo consoles and give them an awesome game counterpart. And it's what they were really excited about was the money. At number 4, we have Final Fantasy XIV. It's a strange case in the sense that it was technically in development for over 5 years, but the work done on it had to be scrapped and restarted time and time again, leading to the final product actually being rushed. Final Fantasy XIV decided to go with an MMORPG approach rather than the standard Final Fantasy formula, but this proved to be too much of an ambitious project, if you will, for the team working on it, especially after all the technical problems that arose. The final product was released blatantly broken and unfinished, as it was clear that the deadlines had finally caught up to Square Enix and taught them a harsh lesson in time management. This one's really bad at number 3, Enter the Matrix. Not much is known about the specifics of the development of this movie tie-in game, but all we do know is that it was rushed like crazy in development. According to sources, the developers were stuck in a situation where they needed to create this awesome, deep, and technical Matrix video game adaptation, but were required to finish it by the release of the next movie, which didn't give them even close to enough time to get it done, and the ending results was a terrible game. At number 2, we go back, all the way to Pac-Man, the Atari 2600 version. The original Pac-Man is, yes, a classic. We're not at all talking about the arcade game. We are talking about the port for the Atari 2600, which is widely regarded as the worst game port of all time, and perhaps one of the worst games of all time. After the popularity of the arcade game, Atari wanted a piece of the action and got the rights to make a port for their 2600 console. Developed in only 4 months by one guy, the port was a complete disaster. It was ugly, horrible sound design, and it was broken. It was almost nothing like the original arcade game. However, the one developer, Todd Fry, got a pretty sweet deal out of it. He signed a deal that required Atari to pay him 10 cents per Pac-Man cartridge that they manufactured. And since Atari was expecting the port to be a hit, Fry ended up being a millionaire with this deal. Okay, there's no doubt about number 1 if you are a video game history enthusiast. It goes to E.T. the Extraterrestrial. Often called the worst game of all time, it is the worst game of all time. It seems only right that we finish up with this amazing, amazing monstrosity. Developed in 5 weeks, once again, for the Atari 2600, E.T. was released just in time for the 1982 holiday season. It didn't go well for Atari, though, as the game was so hated and so terrible that there was a massive backlash against the gaming industry, causing it to crash in 1983. To cover up their embarrassment, Atari famously crushed all their unsold cartridges of E.T. and buried the remains in the desert. And I think after Pac-Man and E.T., Atari learned a valuable lesson about rushed game development. And there you have it, my friends. Those are 10 games that had a super short development cycle, and they paid the price for it. Let me know what ones we missed. There's a playlist below if you guys want to check out all the other top 10s. I put up a brand new one every single night at 8 o'clock Central Standard Time. There's also a link below if you want to submit ideas for future top 10s. Who knows? It could end up being on the channel. Thank you for all the support. Drop a like and make sure you're subscribed, and I'll see you tomorrow night for a new one.